Good morning and welcome to the Cellar Church Online. We are so pleased that you've chosen to join us this morning.
We really hope that you'll feel blessed and encouraged as well as challenged as we join together to worship before a living God.
Come thou fount of every blessing, to my heart to sing thy praise. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise.
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art.
Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above.
Waking or sleeping, thy presence, my life. I need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like thine can peace afford.
Let us join together in saying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
So good to have you with us this morning at the Cellar Church Online. And what a great reminder that the God we have come to worship this Sunday morning is a God who gives us blessings upon blessings. We have so many things to give thanks to him for this morning. Tell you what, why don't you just shout out right now in your home, wherever you are, one blessing that God's given you. Go on, have a go. See, that's just one thing. But how many other things has God given to us? We live in a world that really is struggling right now to find anything good on the news or anything good really to talk about or to share. But we have a God who has promised to take care of us and to give us good things. Let's hear God's word as Tony Mee reads for us.
I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness.
There's a song in my soul, and I feel it stirring in me. This I know for sure, that your love is like a flood, and your mercy never ending. I give my song to you. There's a joy in my soul, and it rises like a morning. This I know for sure, that your grace is enough, and your promise never breaking. I give my song to you. Roll up.
See, it's good that God puts a song in our heart and we're able to worship him. Well, we haven't got three things to know this morning, but just a couple of things to remind you of or to tell you about. The first is next week, next Sunday morning, we're going to share communion together right here online, and two of our church leaders are going to lead us in that. So you might want to prep for that at home. As a family, you might want to get some wine or juice and some bread, that we can remember the Lord's death together as part of our service, which will be absolutely wonderful. Now, things are changing. Next Sunday morning, we have the opportunity to get back to the town hall. Just a few of us to start with. You've just about got time to sign up for that online. So feel free to do that. Get on the website or the Facebook page and sign up to join us next Sunday at the town hall. Now, we're still running an online service, and so you can watch that service and attend if you want to. Kind of more of a connect group at the town hall. We'd love to see you there. Well, as we continue in our time together, kids, it is that time again. So wherever you are, it's time to call the kids. Let's get them together. Last week we talked about animals, but I wonder, have you ever been fishing? Now, if you are part of the Cellar Church congregation, you will know that we have at least one avid, if not obsessed, fisherman. And Lee Sharp has caught fish as big as this. He's a really good fisherman. But I wonder whether you've ever been fishing. Kids, I used to fish when I was little and probably about your age. I've got to be honest, I wasn't very good at it because it involved sitting still for a long time. And I'm not very good at that even now. But you used to put the little worm on the hook and then you used to throw it into the lake or the pond or even into the sea. And I caught some interesting fish. But today, as we look at God's story, we're going to learn about a fish that was huge. In fact, God used that fish to bring a man to a point where he had to go God's way. Let's listen to the account of the life of Jonah.
Heroes of the Bible, Jonah. This is Jonah. Jonah was a prophet. That means it was his job to tell people what God told him to say.
Yep.
One day, God told Jonah to go to Nineveh because the people of Nineveh were doing bad things. But instead, Jonah ran away.
Where are you, please?
And went to the port to board a ship, going the other way. He was hoping to get away from God. He sailed for a place called Tarshish. While he was at sea, God sent a great and powerful wind over the sea that caused a storm that seemed like it would break the ship apart. Fearing for their lives, the sailors tried everything they could think of to save the ship. Meanwhile, Jonah was sound asleep, so the captain went down and said, "How can you sleep at a time like this? Get up and pray to your God. Maybe he will help us." Then the crew figured out that Jonah was the reason for the storm. And they asked him, "Who are you? Why is this happening to us?" Jonah told them who he was and that he worshiped the one true God who made the sea. Then he told the sailors to throw him in the sea so the storm would stop.
"No, why?"
The sailors still tried to escape the storm, but it was no use. So they asked God for forgiveness and threw Jonah into the sea. The storm stopped at once.
Whoa!
The sailors were amazed at God's power and they vowed to serve him. Now God sent a great fish to swallow Jonah.
Great.
And Jonah was inside the fish for 3 days and nights. Jonah prayed to God from inside the fish, and God ordered the fish to spit Jonah out.
Yuck.
God told Jonah again to go to the city of Nineveh to tell them what God had said about them.
I get it.
This time, Jonah obeyed God and went to Nineveh to deliver God's message. The people of Nineveh stopped doing bad things and turned to God. They were saved because they listened to the message that God had given Jonah.
So Jonah was given a command to go to Nineveh, a place he didn't really want to go, and he tried to run away from God. Do you know, kids, we can't run away from God. God drew Jonah back and promised to go with him. And eventually, Jonah trusted him. And do you know, throughout your lives, you are going to face some challenges. But you need to trust God, just as Jonah did, eventually. Well, one of the biggest challenges is going to happen just this week. For some of you are going to be returning back to school. Some of our pupils, some of our teachers and teaching staff are going back into the classroom for the first time since lockdown. And oh boy, is it going to be different. So this week, I thought I'd catch up with a few of you to find out what you're looking forward to about going back to school and maybe some of the things that you're most anxious about. Let's hear some of your answers.
I'm looking forward to going back to school because I'll be able to go back to my friends and I'll have a new teacher. And I'll also get to do maths lessons. But sadly, I'll have to do English lessons every day.
In September,
I'm not looking forward to going back to school because it means I won't get to spend every day with my dogs. But I am looking forward to go see my friends again and make new friends.
What I'm looking forward to about going back to school is seeing my friends. What I'm not looking forward to is tons of homework. Honestly.
Going back to school is being able to see my friends as I haven't been able to see them for a long time. When we go back to school, I'm not looking forward to having homework again.
When we go back to school, I am looking forward to seeing my friends again. And I'm not looking forward to is having homework and doing the work.
I'm looking forward to seeing my friends again and learning new subjects. Also meeting my new form tutor, Mr. Heaven. What I'm not looking forward to is having to wake up early to catch the bus and having a change of environment in a bigger school.
What we're all looking forward to being at school is seeing all our friends. But what I'm not looking forward to is seeing our teachers giving us a big pile of work to do.
I don't like school because I like home.
The thing I'm not looking forward to is the mile-long list of homework.
Morgan, what are you most looking forward to about going back to school?
Seeing all my friends again.
Have you got any worries about the year ahead?
Well, that the work's going to be harder in class three.
So, Sarah, what are you looking forward to about going back to school?
I'm looking forward to going to a new school and making new friends.
Sarah, and anything that you're a bit worried about?
I'm worried about getting lost.
Evan, what are you looking forward to about going back to school?
Starting a new school with longer holidays.
Evan, anything that you're not looking forward to?
Going back to school.
So more than anything, I'm looking forward to just getting back into the classroom and telling stories, which is all I really do. And it's far easier to tell those stories when you've got actual, real children in front of you rather than looking at a computer screen. I'm not looking forward to probably having to wear a face mask and the worries about whether this virus all kicks off again.
What I'm really hoping for going back into school is meeting some new people. I'm returning to school after a break of about 4 years. And I'm really hoping that everybody settles in well and they enjoy themselves and we all just get along. That's what I'm hoping for. I think my concerns, my worries, it's just a different way of living now, a different way of working. I'm not sure how it's going to work in school, and I think most teachers feel like that and students feel like that as well. But I'm convinced that we'll all just get on with it, everything will be fine, and we'll work out how we're going to deal with it all in the classroom. So enjoy school, all of you, when you come back.
So these are going to be really challenging times for many of you, and we want you to pray, and at TCC we want you committed to pray for our kids and for our teaching staff and those who are going to be going back into the classroom. We're going to do that right now as Chris Minton leads us in prayer. Let's come before our God.
Heavenly Father, we thank you that if you've accepted your Son as our Saviour, your presence is with us through every stage in our lives. You promise that you will never leave us or forsake us. In the knowledge of this promise, which as your children each one of us can claim for our own, we have the confidence to walk through each day. As children, young people and those working in schools start a new term, we know that they will be facing many changes that they will need to navigate their way through. For both those starting new schools and those returning to a new way of working, we ask you to keep them safe. Give wisdom and strength to the staff as they guide, support and teach their pupils. We pray that the pupils will abide by the restrictions that have been put in place to keep them safe. We also pray for those vulnerable pupils who during the time of lockdown will have been exposed to harmful experiences in their homes. We pray that schools will be able to provide the emotional and pastoral support that these children will need. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that you delight in hearing our prayers, and we offer this prayer to you as your children. You are the Almighty Victor, and we can rely on you for each moment of each day. Amen.
John 16, starting at verse 16. The disciples' grief will turn to joy. Jesus went on to say, "In a little while you will see me no more, and then after a little while you will see me." At this, some of his disciples said to one another, "What does he mean by saying, 'In a little while you will see me no more, and then after a little while you will see me, and because I am going to the Father?'" They kept asking, "What does he mean by 'a little while'? We don't understand what he is saying." Jesus saw that they wanted to ask him about this. So he said to them, "Are you asking one another what I meant when I said, 'In a little while you will see me no more, and then after a little while you will see me'? Very truly I tell you, you will weep and mourn while the world rejoices. You will grieve, but your grief will turn to joy. A woman giving birth to a child has pain because her time has come. But when her baby is born, she forgets the anguish because of her joy that a child is born into the world. So with you, now is your time of grief, but I will see you again, and you will rejoice, and no one will take away your joy. In that day, you will no longer ask me anything. Very truly, I tell you, my Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. Until now, you have not asked for anything in my name. Ask, and you will receive, and your joy will be complete."
There's an old and ancient Chinese saying that says this: if you wish to be happy for 1 hour, get intoxicated. If you wish to be happy for 3 days, get married. If you wish to be happy for 8 days, kill your pig and eat it. If you wish to be happy forever, learn to fish. Well, evidently, the fellow who wrote that, and it must have been a fellow who wrote that proverb, discovered that it was possible to get more pleasure out of eating pork chops and putting a rod into a lake than spending time with your wife. I really wouldn't recommend that. But it may be an old saying, but it is a question. What makes for ultimate happiness? What makes for lasting happiness? Where do we find real joy? Not just a moment of joy, but where do we find joy that will last a lifetime and, in fact, forever? Well, the Scottish preacher Alexander Wyatt observed this. "We all as human beings tend to hang heavy weights on the thinnest of wires." What he actually meant is that we hang things like happiness on very fragile, inadequate foundations. You know, lasting joy can't come that way. We lay it on our friends, our mates, our health, our homes, our children, our jobs, and we hang all these things on the thin wire. And that's where we think we find our happiness. Now, all of those are blessings of God. Those are all good things. But they are not a foundation for lasting joy. Why? Because all of them are uncertain. Because all of them are transitory. They're just moving on. The love of the world that we have fallen into quite often is this love of considering everything to satisfy us. We looked at that a few weeks ago, didn't we? That we can have hearts that are not troubled. But those are hearts that ensure that they are living for Jesus. Sadly, I've witnessed many Christian believers who have been completely wiped out spiritually because they didn't expect and they didn't know how to face suffering biblically. Some have made the mistake of thinking that there is a notion that once we've entrusted our lives to Jesus Christ, then we are protected from major trials, major sufferings, or tragedy in our lives. They feel that If that happens, then God's abandoned us, or that even we have made a mistake and God, therefore, is punishing us. When things don't work out as we want them to, that when our lives begin to fall apart, that maybe it's because we have a lack of faith. In fact, some churches even teach that. They even teach the fact that if you suffer, then effectively it's your fault, you're unspiritual. I read a phrase during the week in one of my quiet times in my devotional reading notes that really stuck with me in my word. And it says this: the wilderness is a place we visit. It is not our ultimate destination. So how do we handle that? How do we handle things when life is not joyful? How do we handle things when there is pain and hurt and wilderness days? Maybe months, perhaps years. As we move on into this chapter of John's Gospel, as we continue to move in the direction that John is, we find Jesus with his disciples. And they are overwhelmed with sorrow. Jesus is preparing them for a huge trial that they would experience in the next few hours. They would watch him be arrested, beaten, mocked, scourged, and eventually crucified and die. In these verses, however, on the cross just a few hours away, Jesus becomes very personal with his disciples. He says that there's tough days ahead. You will face those days and you will have to face those days. But there is some great news that's going to follow. At this point, the disciples really didn't realise or fully understand or have any idea of what was about to happen, what was coming. In those moments, their world was going to come crashing down around them. They had put their hopes, they'd staked their futures on the belief that Jesus was the promised Messiah, that he was going to build a new kingdom, that he was going to rule over Israel and overcome the Roman occupiers. The previous Sunday, I guess their hopes must have been heightened, because there had been the triumphal entry, there'd been the crowds, there'd been the cheering, there'd been the hosannas. But now, everything they had hoped for would come to a sudden, shocking end as they watched their Lord suffer and die. But Jesus wants to prepare them, and he wants to prepare us for days of suffering. And how does he do that? He teaches us. He teaches us that we need to entrust those times, those anxieties, those fears into God's hands and be reminded that we are never, ever abandoned by God. Listen to what we read there in verse 16. In a little while, you will no longer see me. And again, a little while, and you will see me. That sounds a little bit confusing, doesn't it? It caused some confusion amongst the disciples, for sure. And on the first read, it's not surprising, is it? It sounds like the words Jesus is using don't make any sense at all, especially when he uses that term, in a little while. There've been a number of different ways that commentators and Bible scholars have looked at that verse and looked at different ways of trying to understand it. But to me, it seems fairly straightforward. And the simplest way to understand that verse 16 is this. When Jesus says, in a little while, I'm going to be gone and you won't see me, Jesus is referring to his imminent death on a cross. He was going to die. And then that second, in a little while you will see me again, I believe refers to his resurrection. That they saw him, even Thomas, with their own eyes. When Jesus was crucified, the disciples wept. They lamented. They felt the pain. They felt the loss. Whilst Jesus' enemies, well, they rejoiced, didn't they? The disciples were there and it hurt. The Pharisees were there and they rejoiced. But after a little while, the disciples saw the risen Jesus and their sorrow would immediately turn to rejoicing once more, that they would again be full of joy for their Jesus. In his explanation, Jesus uses a picture. It's a picture of a woman in childbirth. And those of us who've had the privilege of having children understand that. That at the time, it isn't pleasant. But once that mother holds that child, what a difference it makes. Verse 22, it says this. So with you. Now is your time of grief. But I will see you again, and you will rejoice, and no one will take away your joy. Friends, joy is not a season. It is a way of living. The great American preacher D.L. Moody once wrote this: "The Lord gives his people perpetual joy when they walk in obedience to him." The Apostle Paul, who knew plenty about grief and turbulence, he writes to the Christians in persecuted Philippi. And he uses these words in Philippians. Philippians chapter 3 and verses 1 to 3. "Whatever happens, my dear brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord. I never get tired of telling you these things." We all have to face sorrow at some point in our lives. And as we've already seen, Christians are not immune to trials. Jesus' disciples weren't. They weren't immune from grief. They weren't somehow shielded from trouble. There were difficult days. There were going to be difficult days. As I've said, there are some groups, some Christian groups, some church groups that teach that the response to Christian suffering is because of a lack of faith or unrepented sin, that there's health, wealth and prosperity. That's all there is for Christians. That is not what the Bible teaches. That is rubbish. Just read this chapter, John chapter 16. Jesus makes it clear, makes it unambiguous, that in the life of the Christian, there will be trouble. There will be suffering. Both he, his disciples, and you and I are left in no doubt that we will face the trials of unemployment, of financial turmoil, of struggles in our marriages and with our kids, the loss of a loved one, an illness. Many of you will know by now that T, my wife, who did our Bible reading today, just a couple of weeks ago, was diagnosed with cancer. Now, were we shocked? Yes. Were we anxious of the unknown? Yes, but not in despair. Were we hurting? Are we hurting? Well, who wouldn't be? And yet, we don't feel crushed or abandoned by God. This is part of life. This is how we have to face things. On discovering the news of T's diagnosis, a friend of hers asked the question, "How on earth could a supposed good God allow someone like you to suffer?" And T's reply, "Why shouldn't it be me? This same good God has an even greater plan." Now, at this point, I want you to understand, there is nothing unspiritual about feeling deep sorrow or grief at a time of suffering and loss. True, our grief as Christians is different to the world. We have an ultimate hope in Christ, 1 Thessalonians 4 and verse 13. And yet, we do feel that pain. Listen, though, what we read in Psalm 46. They're well-known words that we need to take to heart. Psalm 46, verse 1 to 4. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging, there is a river whose streams make glad the city of God. Yes, there is grief. Yes, there is trouble. And yes, it can be hard to cope with. We are human at least. But we have a Father in heaven who holds us in the very palm of his hands. So sorrow, trouble, is a reality. But it might be caused by lots of different things. Here in these verses this morning, in John chapter 16, I believe Jesus helps us identify just a few of the factors that will bring us sorrow in this life. And the first is this. Sorrow can come from disappointment when things don't go the way we'd hoped. The comment of the men on the road to Emmaus, and you'll remember that following the resurrection, the death and resurrection of Jesus, those men walked along the road to Emmaus, and as they talked together, they didn't recognize who he was. And they were kind of the disciples who had that conversation. Luke 24, verse 21 says this. When questioned about what was going on, they said this, but we were hoping that he was going to redeem Israel. Speaking of Jesus, there was a hope and it didn't work out, and we're told they were downcast. They'd hoped the Messiah would establish a reign and a kingdom, just like the other disciples. That there'd be peace and blessing, just as prophesied in the Old Testament. And they'd taken it for granted that that would happen in Jesus. But it didn't work out that way, did it? It appeared at that time to be a disaster. And they are deeply disappointed, and it brings them to sorrow. When you've hoped, when you've prayed that a certain situation would work out differently, and you've trusted God, and it didn't work out as you wanted, Satan will tell you that God didn't answer your prayer. Yes, he did. But he didn't answer it in the way you expected. It brings trouble. Second way that sorrow comes is when we have confusion about our circumstances. Look at these disciples. They were really confused about all that was happening. From the excitement of the triumphal entry, now to being told that it was all going to go wrong. They are disorientated emotionally and spiritually. And the next few hours, they are going to be all over the place as Jesus suffers and is shamed and dies. They didn't understand that. They didn't understand that that was very much part of God's plan and very much part of the scriptures. They didn't understand that. And in the same way, there are times when we go through experiences and situations that we don't understand and we don't get it. We don't get why something has happened to us or one of our loved ones and it tears us up. It's easy at those points to forget, in the middle of our confusion, to forget the promises of the Bible. Maybe we have a preconceived idea about how things should turn out. But we forget that when we look at our pathway in life, God has said that his way is not always our way. His plans are not always our plans. However, he is perfect in all that he does. Confusion? Well, that'll lead to sorrow. Third thing, sorrow comes from the seeming triumph of evil. Doesn't that hurt a lot? Somehow, We see people who have done the most ungodly things, maybe to us or to our family, who have ungodly agendas, who've hurt, who've caused chaos. They seem to be prevailing. They seem to be in that position. They seem to be prevailing while the righteous suffer, and it tears us up. Jesus tells his disciples, the world will rejoice over his death. The smug religious leaders high-fiving each other, enjoying each other's company, seeming their plan come together. The rebel preacher of Galilee now dispatched to eternity. Maybe we look back. It's easy for us to look back at the resurrection and the ascension, and we can look back, we know the end of the story. And so it's easy for us. It wasn't for those disciples. We saw how things worked out, but they hadn't seen that yet. And they were sorrowful. They were grieving. But the final thing, sorrow comes from living in a fallen world. You see, because of Adam and Eve's sin, way back in creation, the world is subject to suffering and to death. You know, just take a moment to read Genesis 3, particularly through verses 17 and 19, or Romans chapter 20, verses 22. You see, although Jesus Christ has conquered death and sin through the cross, we still live in that fallen world and in our fallen bodies with a sinful nature. It's still subject to disease. We are still subject to pain and the consequences of our wrongdoing and other people's wrongdoing. You see, there is sadness. Sometimes that deep pain takes years to work through, not fixed overnight. Being Christians doesn't insulate us or stop us experiencing pain or sorrow. But here is the good news, the biggest news, the greatest news, the most exciting news. Verse 33. Now, I don't know whether you underline verses in your Bible, but you need to underline this verse. It is a key verse. And for me and for our family, this has become not just another verse in a chapter of John's Gospel. It has become so precious. In the whole of John's Gospel, there is not another verse that jumps out. During this pandemic, there is not another verse that jumps out of this one. In the fear and the anxiety and the uncertainty, here is the great verse. It's going to go up on your screen. Maybe put it as your screensaver on your phone. Put it on your laptop. Stick it up on the wall. For Jesus says this, I have told you these things so that you may have peace. For in this world you will have trouble. But take heart, I have overcome the world. Friends, at TCC, here's a heads up. Don't be surprised if John 16, 33 doesn't become a text as a church for 2021. In the aftermath of COVID-19 and all that's gone on, that seems to me very appropriate. In life, it is pretty much guaranteed, says Jesus. The truth is, there will be trouble. But there is just as equally great truth that there is hope. There is a certainty. There is a promise. The risen Lord Jesus Christ has overcome the world and the trouble that you face on a daily basis. In response to his followers' struggle, in response to their grief and their trials, he's honest with them. I know you're going to have trouble, he says, but he is gracious and patient, and he acknowledges their confusion, and in just a few short words, he brings them a certainty that there would be joy. Hebrews 4:15, we read these amazing words. For we do not have a high priest that cannot sympathise with our weaknesses, but one who has been tempted in all things as we are, and yet without sin. In verse 22, Jesus says, I understand your grief, but you will see me again, and joy will return, and no one can snatch it away. Do you hear that? No one can snatch away the hope that Jesus Christ gives to those who are suffering and those who are facing trials. The hope cannot be snatched away, Christian, by anybody or anything, although they will try. It's a dramatic change for these Christians, from grief to everlasting joy, from temporary pain to everlasting certainty. Everything about the Christian faith rests on the resurrection of Jesus Christ to life and life eternal. Paul states that. 1 Corinthians 15, 17 says, if Christ has not been raised, our faith is worthless. You are still in your sins. And then he goes on, he says, but he has been raised. He has been raised. The apostles are going to be transformed from fearful, defeated, confused men to bold witnesses to the truth. Yes, they would suffer for their witness, but they will speak clearly of what God had done for them in that time of need. Note what Jesus doesn't say to the disciples here. He doesn't say that sorrow would be replaced by joy, but rather he would turn the sorrow into joy. Often there are times of suffering where we see Jesus more clearly. Yes, we trust him more. Of course, it's true for Christians that ultimately we do have joy in eternity, and that all the sorrow, all the tears will be swept away. We have that certain hope. But what about here and what about now? You might be thinking, couldn't we just skip the pain, the disease, the bereavement, the hurt? Hebrews 5:8 says that even Jesus learnt obedience through his suffering. Suffering is there for a reason. Through our suffering, we lean less on ourselves and more on our God. Through our suffering and through that process, we learn more about God's comfort and the precious nature of the fellowship of believers. And during that time of suffering, during those troubles, we learn so much more of what God has promised to do for us. Ian Bounds was an amazing writer. He wrote specifically about prayer. And he wrote this: trouble and prayer are closely related. Trouble often drives men to God in prayer, while prayer is but the voice of men in trouble. In times of suffering, you're going to spend more time in the presence of God. It's in the context of suffering that Jesus speaks to these disciples, these men, and asks the Father to take care of them. This morning, we need to take our pain, our suffering, our hurts, and we need to put them into eternal perspective. Listen again to what the Apostle Paul writes in Romans chapter 8 and verse 18. He says these words that should lift our spirits. For I consider the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is going to be revealed to us. Friends, again, let me look you in the eye, just as Jesus looked his disciples in the eye. There is light at the end of the tunnel. There truly is. There is a safe haven in the storm that you are currently experiencing. And there is someone who has overcome the world and the circumstances and the trial. It's Jesus. Will you trust him? Will you let him bear that sorrow? Will you take it to him? And will you have a heart that is comforted? The song by Matt West has become a bit of a theme song during lockdown and our pandemic for us as a church online. And it's certainly become a theme song that I love. And we've used it online probably more than any of the other songs. It's especially relevant based on the verse that we have here. It's a song that's based on verse 33 of John 16. Take heart, even this morning.
Woke up this morning, and life as you know it looks nothing like the kind of life you knew before. All of a sudden, fear stole the headlines, and it don't feel safe to even step outside your door. In this world, you will have trouble, but I have overcome the world. So take heart and take a breath. Let me lift that heavy weight up off your chest. And take my hand, I know it's looking dark. When the world falls all around you, I won't let you fall apart. Take heart. Take heart. Do you remember singing back when you were younger? He's got the whole world in his hands. Well, that's still true. I hold your family, all your friends, and all your loved ones. And even when you're barely holding on, I'm holding you. So take heart and take a breath. And let me lift that heavy weight up off your chest. And take my hand, I know it's looking dark. When the world falls all around you, I won't let you fall apart. Take heart. Take heart. Oh, take heart. Just take heart. In this world, but I have overcome the world. Oh, in this world you will have trouble, but I have overcome the world. So take heart and take a breath, and let me lift that heavy weight up off your chest. Take my hand, I know it's looking dark. When the world falls all around you, I won't let you fall apart. So take heart, child, take heart.
Dear loving Father, we thank you for your unfailing, unconditional love towards us, for a love that brought us into being and breathed life into us. You knew us before the creation of the world, and that you brought us into being for this very time. Thank you for the amazing plans that you have for each of our lives, and for revealing the depth of love for each and every one of us. Father, we've all turned to our own way and relied upon our own thoughts, and this has led us away from you. Many are experiencing the brokenness of that relationship with you. Many are brokenhearted. Many are experiencing internal loneliness. Many have broken relationships with family and friends. Many are afraid and anxious. Father, we thank you that you saw us in this way, needing you, needing new life, that you sent your one and only Son into the world to restore us, to save us, and you still remain forever a Saviour, not treating us as our sins deserve. Father, I lift these people to you, knowing you are a God who heals us, who heals the brokenhearted, who binds up their wounds, that Jesus was pierced for our rebellion and crushed for our sins, that Jesus took the beating so that we could be made whole, that Jesus was whipped so that we could be healed. And it's by these stripes that we are healed, for surely he has carried all our sicknesses and diseases. And because of Jesus, we can have true rest and true peace. We thank you, Lord, that because of Jesus, you pour your Spirit out on all flesh. And I pray that eyes and ears would be open to your goodness, because it's your goodness that leads us to repentance. So, Father, I thank you that we can pray for these people, for people that know you, that still need to experience your Holy Spirit, that still need your Holy Spirit to rest upon them. We thank you that we can praise you and lift you high. And we pray that in the name of our Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you for joining us at TCC this morning. And don't forget to join us for TCC Extra in a few minutes.
And remember, whatever your week holds for you, we have a God who wants us to bring all our burdens to him. The Lord bless you.
Children and their children may favor
Beside you, all around you, and within.